Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
It just hasn't been a good month for you. I ask questions, I get the wrong answers. Or no answer. I mean, the one that gets me is when I get nothing and dead air.
What can I say? Sometimes you stump me a little bit.
I feel like just showing up. There's a certain underlying theme to the show. Who's the foil? If you can't figure out the foil of the show, we might as well just bring Tony in.
Get the lingerie on the deck. Call the janitor.
Yeah, I deserve that one.
Just kidding. We're having a good time today. Brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, great new inventory, best in pre-owned inventory because that is the Sunbury Motors guarantee, and whether it's inspections, routine, or diagnostics, they handle all of it in that great service department. It is one-stop vehicle shopping for the life of the vehicle every time. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. We're at Scarcella in a moment. Play-by-play call of the day. Providence prevails in triple overtime over Xavier.
Charging. Not going to be able to go one-on-one if he hits the shot clock. From way downtown.
There were a couple of people complained, only a couple, that the Providence Xavier game was going so long they were missing out on Wyoming and Colorado State. Okay.
F-O-U-L-E, that spells
foul. Stop. I realize Wyoming's ranked 22nd. I got that. But I mean, you sit back and go, really? This game's so good. What are you talking about? All right, let's turn to Rich Scarcella, Reading Eagle. Rich, welcome. It's always great to have you with us.
Great to hear from you, Steve. How are you?
I'm doing well, and hope you are doing well. Hope your family's well. Interesting times. There's so much going on with name, image, and likeness, transfer portals, winter workouts, and college football playoff, and TV contracts. So let's get to the college football playoff. You know, I don't know if we're all surprised at this hour. Based on recent events, it's going to stay at four for a bit. But what did you think?
I thought that's what they were going to do all along, that they weren't going to tear up the existing contract. I do think when this is over, I think it's 2026.
Yes.
Contract ends. I believe you're going to see 8 and possibly 12 teams in the playoff. Would I have liked to have seen that sooner? Yes, but I didn't expect them to change that.
All right. Now, let me bring this up as a side. Right now for networks, they could have bid on it if it went to 12. Right. Okay. Well, that's not going to happen for a couple of years. The NHL is off the NBC books at $100 million a year.
Does the Big Ten actually benefit with its TV contract up next that they could get more money and then eventually get the benefit of an expanded playoff?
Oh, I think the Big Ten is going to pursue what the best deal it possibly can. And, you know, if that's with NBC, that's with NBC. The interesting thing, and again, I'm not telling you anything new, is that the Big Ten Network isn't half of it, or close to half of it, owned by Fox.
Right.
And so I don't know how that complicates, you know, network contracts with the Big Ten if they have an exclusivity with Fox, or I'm guessing they don't, but I don't know. But I can see them going to NBC because NBC is looking for content. And especially on Saturday afternoons in the fall, I mean, they do have Notre Dame, but that's just one game a week. So that wouldn't surprise me. I do think they'll pursue it, though. I think they'll pursue the best deal that they can get.
And the other part is CBS, which will be out of the SEC. They're going to want content.
That's also true, Steve. Great point. If, you know, we forget that ESPN is taking over the SEC coverage or SEC package too. So yeah, I think it's going to be really interesting to see what develops over the next several years. But you know, I believe, and you know, I know Jim Delaney's not there anymore, but I do believe that the Big Ten will get the best package it can possibly get with whatever network.
All right. Especially after, I think they released all the numbers on everybody. I guess 11 out of the 14 lost eight figures or more last year, which was expected. What I didn't expect was three only lost seven figures. I said, wow, how'd they do that? Don't know, but they did. I think Illinois lost like $3.5 million or some number like that. Name, image, and likeness. During his press conference, James Franklin, back on the first Wednesday of the month, you know, spent some time talking about, look, staying ahead. How difficult is it for any school to stay ahead in this atmosphere of name, image, and likeness, especially considering the market you're in versus maybe a market somebody else is in?
To stay ahead of some other competitors?
Yes, to stay ahead of other competitors where you feel like people come to your school and they're getting the best they can out of name, image, and likeness.
Yeah, well, this is a hot topic with James Franklin, as you probably know.
Yes.
And I see that they're advertising, the university is advertising for somebody to direct those efforts, which if you would put James Franklin on a lie detector, I'm sure he would say that it was overdue. And I do think that being in central Pennsylvania, where I spent a lot of time and where I have spent a lot of time and an area where I love, is not the same as spending it in Columbus, which is the capital of Ohio. It's a smaller market, plain and simple. The opportunities with NIL in Center County aren't as great. So I'm guessing whoever takes this job is going to have to reach out and spread out and try to negotiate deals in Philadelphia and Pittsburgh, that kind of thing, throughout the state, rather than just focus on Center County. But I know I wrote a column, I think it was, I can't remember, a month ago, the days are going by so fast.
Yeah.
And that some of the deals a month ago were incredible. Ohio State claims that it has the number one NIL packages for its athletes. Texas, we got at USC. Look at Caleb Williams, got a deal as soon as he transferred, basically, from Oklahoma to USC. So, yeah, Penn State is behind, and this is something that I don't think the NCAA is going to go back on, and it's borderline professionalism.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And well, like it or not, that's what the situation is. And if you don't want to participate, you're going to be left behind.
And that's the bottom line, right? Because this, in some ways, is playing out like I thought maybe a couple of years ago, that Columbus is the largest city in the state. There's a lot of industry in that city. And then you look at Alabama. In Alabama, you and I both know there are no pro entities there. I say that with all due respect to the Birmingham Stallions of the USFL. And but they're the franchise in that state. Here, you got the Eagles, the Steelers, the Penguins, the Flyers, the Sixers, the Phillies, the Pirates, and, you know, and then there's Penn State. I mean, there's a lot of competition just in your own state.
Yes, there is. And I go back to when Joe Paterno and Jim Tarman traveled around the state trying to basically drum up support for Penn State football back in the 1960s and early 70s. I mean, that's what Penn State's market, clientele, however you want to put it, that's what it is. It's really, truly throughout the state. They're the people who have supported Penn State football for the longest period of time.
Yes.
Are the most loyal and ardent fans of the program. And, you know, whether that's in, you know, Wilkes-Barre, Scranton, Hazleton, my hometown, or down here in Berks County in Reading, or wherever, you know, that's a clientele that should not be ignored, and businesses that should not be ignored. And I'm sure once this person is hired, whoever that may be, they're going to find that out fairly quickly. You're right. In Philadelphia and Pittsburgh, there's intense competition for the disposable income dollar, and that's going to be a big issue. So, but yeah, I mean, Penn State, you know, this has been going on for almost what, a year and a half, 2 years, Steve.
Yeah.
NIL.
Yeah.
And you know, you got to get out ahead of this if you want to compete for a national championship. That's just the facts. I mean, whether we like it or not, that's just the way it is.
Right. No, exactly right. And I think James framed it correctly. Ask yourself, what do you want to compete for? Well, everyone knows Penn State wants to compete for the national title. To do that, you got to go toe to toe in every area.
Yes.
Along the way.
Yes.
This is. Major League Baseball is going through its lockout phase right now.
Mm-hmm.
I have found there have been several interesting and fascinating articles that have been written about baseball, that an area they're not talking about because the owners elect not to talk about. The players are willing to talk about it. But how do you frame the game right now in terms of time and how it's being played? So, and let me get everybody just to, you know, help here. College basketball is expected to fit into two-hour windows, right, as we all know, okay? College football is one that's warping a little bit longer every single year. Rich, all the games you've watched, where are, you know, with more passing and more incompletions, games will go longer. I've got that. Is there any way that college football can reel something in its time frame to instead of expanding the time it takes to play a game, contract it a bit?
Well, the first thing is won't ever happen, and that's to shorten the length of commercial time, TV timeouts. Shorten it. You know, whether you have one spot, two spots, three spots, whatever.
Yeah.
And those TV timeouts, quote unquote, last. Steve, what? You know better. 2.5 minutes? 3 minutes?
It depends on the network. They can get 3 minutes if it's an ABC game, and if it's a Big Ten network game, I think it's like 2:30 or something like that.
Well, you and I know. It, you know, when it involves money, that's not going to change.
Exactly, yeah.
Unfortunately. I mean, those timeouts, to me, break the momentum of the game, the flow of the game. You know, people are just sitting there on their hands inside stadiums, whether it's Beaver Stadium or somewhere else. That's one thing, but that's not going to change.
Right.
So they need to try to adjust the rules. Don't stop the clock for first downs.
Agreed.
You know, that's first. I mean, that's what okay, how much does that take off? Who knows? Does it take off 3 minutes? I don't know. In a game? I don't know. I've never timed it. But then you also have to have, I mean, they're already doing that. You know, the clock runs even after a catch is made out of bounds.
Yeah, until 2 minutes to go, yes.
Right. So, and then incomplete passes, you know, most you know, at the end of the game, you throw sometimes that you want to stop the clock, you spike the ball. Well, do you do that? Do you allow that just in the last 5 minutes? Do you allow it all game? Do you, what, like, or whatever? I don't know. I mean, are incomplete passes, should you continue running the clock? These are all things for rules committee people to discuss, but that's really the main culprit in the length of games is the TV timeouts, but that's right. Not going to change.
That's not going to change. And, you know, the odd part is I'd cut 5 minutes off halftime. I mean, right now halftime is 20 minutes. The NFL's 12, so 15, because I don't want to cut out anything that the blue band does.
I mean, Steve, that's a great point. You're right. I thought of that. You're right. 20 minutes is way too long.
Yeah, and you wouldn't have to cut off what the blue band does, because, you know, there are people that are loyal. They love that halftime show. I got it. But they don't take the full 20 minutes. You and I both see, after the band's done, there's a lot of dead time.
Yes, there is.
Right? And that's the time I say you've got to cut out and just, you know, now we're up to cutting the game back in what we're talking about here between stoppage of the clock on first downs and so forth. I think we've now reeled the game back maybe 8-9 minutes.
And at least that's progress. At least that's something. You know, will the game still last 3:15 or 3:20? Probably. But at least that's something. I mean, some of these games, it's hard to watch sitting there watching it, and I can't even imagine people at home, like, you know, you're sitting there for 3.5 minutes in the action, and that's not good. That's just not.
So there's only so many sandwiches you can make. All right, our gang earlier was talking about Aaron Rodgers. So let's talk to the guy that has been the quarterback for the Packers since Brett Favre.
Yes.
Yeah. So can you, as a longtime Packers watcher, can you figure out what the heck he's saying?
Oh, in the IG? No, I think, I mean, we probably have talked about this on your show.
Probably. Or off the air, too. We've probably talked about it.
Yeah. I enjoy watching him play football.
Yep.
I think it's clear that he loves to be the center of attention off the field.
Yeah.
And loves, maybe he doesn't love the drama, but he seems to thrive on it.
Yes.
And I'm telling you, the last 2 weeks, and just even a little bit ago, before you guys called me, I mean, his name every morning is mentioned on ESPN's talk shows.
Yes.
Ad nauseum.
Yes.
I mean, like, I'll give you an example. I don't want to say who the person was. I just watched a national talk show. The host is a guy I really like.
Yeah.
And had a national reporter who for a major network talking to him about Aaron Rodgers and said, well, he's going to make a decision soon. Oh, yeah? And he's either going to re-sign with the Packers, ask for a trade, or retire. Oh, I didn't know that.
Wow, I didn't realize that those were the options. Really?
They must be told they have to mention Aaron Rodgers 10 times a day or something. Yeah. I mean, come on. He has said he's going to make a decision before the free agency period. When's the free agency period? Oh, it's coming up in, what, less than 2 weeks?
Yeah.
Of course he's going to make a decision soon. He has said that repeatedly.
I know.
It drives me. I'm sorry, I'm getting animated.
Oh, no, I understand. I'm with you.
It drives me nuts. Okay, that's it.
No, I'm with you. I mean, because the coverage is nonstop. It's like every time LeBron has a press conference, everything. Listen to what LeBron had to say. I don't care. I don't care what he has to say. It's like, all right, I got it.
Yeah.
Well, your last movie wasn't very good. I got it. All right. My friend, thank you so much. I appreciate it. I was glad we were able to work this out.
Thanks, Steve. Always good to talk to you. Thanks for having me.
You too, my friend.
Bye.
Rich Scarcella, Reading Eagle.
I like Feisty Rich.
Feisty Rich.
Yeah.
Hey, it matches up with Feisty You. Hey, everybody knows you're feisty now. The real Matt Cotrillo comes out. You know, mild-mannered. No. Well, you are feisty.
But in Rich's case, rightfully so.
Oh, there's moments where you're justified, but, you know, it's actually mostly on small items. All right, we'll come back. Come back with more in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by Subaru Motors.
When car repairs get difficult.
Well, I just don't know.
Me neither.
We get good. Sunbury Motors. More than quality new and used cars, Sunbury Motors specializes in complicated auto repair diagnosis. They can handle intricate repairs and even complete auto body with service open Monday through Friday, 7 till 4. And Sunbury Motors has made simple repairs easy. Maintaining your vehicle is necessary. Finding the time to do it is difficult. Welcome to Sunbury Motors Quick Lane. Open 7 till 4, Monday through Friday. Just walk in or call ahead. Relax in their remodeled waiting room with Wi-Fi, beverages, and snacks. While Sunbury Motors factory trained techs take care of your oil change, tire alignments, brakes, and inspections. Quick Lane, 6:30 to 6, Monday through Friday, Saturday, 6:30 till 2. Sunbury Motors, Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury. And Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. We take the out of auto repair.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf. Online at sunburymotors.com. Ford Kia Hyundai, best in new inventory, great pre-owned inventory with the Sunbury Motors Guarantee. And a fabulous service department, whether it's routine inspections or diagnostics, they take care of it all. At Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf. Online at sunburymotors.com. Great to be joined, as always, by Bob Nightengale, USA Today. My friend, welcome back. Great to have you with us again.
Yeah, my pleasure, Steve.
All right, so, Bob, where do we stand today?
Well, they, met this morning for about 30 minutes, and, they're meeting again this afternoon. So, and it's like anything else. Everybody waits the deadline. Deadline's midnight Monday. I still think that if they're close, they could push a book back to Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. I have a hard time believing they can't get a deal done by the by the end of next week.
Well, where, in your opinion, based on your reporting, where do they need to close the gap so they feel comfortable they can close it out?
Well, they haven't even started talking about the collective bargaining tax yet, the luxury tax. So that's a little worrisome. They're still far apart there. But, as far as a salary arbitration, now it's like, the players have said, okay, how about the top 75% of the guys who have 2 years service? Baseball is 22%, top 22%. And there's a big difference in the money as far as how much is in that pool. Whether it's a $95 million difference between the two sides. And even, the minimum salary, they're far apart, but they can easily meet in the middle and give about $700,000 for minimum salary. It used to be $570,000. So I think the owners are on board as far as giving younger players the money. Where they differ is that they still want to penalize the teams that spend big to help out the small market teams.
Is there a sense of urgency on each side?
Well, yeah. I mean, MLB yesterday told the players, hey, if we don't get a deal done by Monday, we're going to have to delay the start of the season. And not delay it, just, cancel games. If we cancel games, you're not getting paid. So there's a sense of urgency there. The players responded by saying, well, then we won't give you a expanded playoffs. You won't be able to wear, decals and patches on corporate sponsors on uniforms, that sort of thing. So I think, no one's presented our best offer yet. I think that's going to come, Sunday, Monday.
Best offer. Okay. I was hoping the best offer would be made last July, but that's all right. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, they, you know, it's like they've had all, you know, they could talk about this all summer long, all winter long. But when the lockout happened on the midnight December 1st, you know, there was another bargain negotiation for 43 days. And they only had six, you know, from then. Then finally, of course, they, you know, sat down in Jupiter, Florida, where they are now. And this is the fourth straight day they've talked. You know, first time they've ever they've talked four straight days.
You love baseball. I love baseball, right? So we both love the game of baseball, the sport of baseball. I wonder sometimes if those in baseball think it's still 1956 where it's baseball, boxing, horse racing, and they don't know it's 2022. That's just my opinion from 30,000 feet. How do you view how they view themselves in the big picture of what sports is?
Well, I think there's some worry there. They got to be worried. I mean, I bet you, Steve, 90% of the country didn't know there was a lockout until Monday after the Super Bowl. It's like, what do you mean spring training's not happening? Right. You know, people weren't talking about baseball. There was a, you know, Gen Z survey nationally, you know, a month or two ago, and you know, so 21 under adults only had baseball as their sixth favorite professional sport, even behind beach volleyball. Tennis has dropped down four straight years. Lowest rated World Series of all time was last year. So they got some problems.
Do they realize they have problems? It's one thing for you and me to recognize there's a problem. Did they realize that?
Well, they should. I mean, just with the you know, the popularity with the declining attendance, declining TV ratings, it should be a wake-up call. You know, we'll see how many sellouts there are this year. I think season ticket sales are down about, or ticket sales in general, down about 30% across the board. People are kind of discussing what's going on and that, you know, a lockout is even happening. So, you know, even when this lockout ends and you start playing baseball, they haven't done anything to change the game. We're still going 6-8 minutes before a ball's being put in play. You know, more strikeouts and walks. So that part hasn't been addressed whatsoever.
Which was going to be my next question. Bob's done the show so many times, he anticipates my next question. and my next question was going to be about that. Now, I don't know if I'm right about this. My understanding was the players were willing to talk about game changes and how the game has changed, but the owners didn't want to at this particular time because there are other they want to get to the economic issues. Am I right or wrong about that?
Well, I think, yeah, the owners didn't want to bog it down. Like, you know, we got enough problems to solve on economic issues. Let's don't mess around with this. It's a, I hate to say waste of time, but they just didn't want to get involved in it. So they said, let's say this. I mean, if they wanted to, Rob Manfred and, you know, MLB office can implement it by giving 1 year notice. So he can still do that before opening day. And he definitely wants a pitch clock. But yeah, I mean, they hired Theo Epstein and everybody else to try to make changes in baseball. And, you know, it's not going to happen for a couple of years.
It's interesting because right now, obviously, I've got another basketball game to do with Northwestern on Friday night. The late Dave Gavitt, when he put together the Big East, always talked about how college basketball needs to fit into two-hour windows for TV. Okay. We know, you know, hockey's about 2:15. Now, football has gone longer because of incomplete passes, but it should be in that 3 to 3:15 range. Baseball, of course, doesn't have a time frame on anything. Do they realize the TV windows, which also satisfies ballpark windows, need to start being satisfied?
Well, yeah. I mean, you know, and the time of game keeps going on. It's like, well, at 3:11 last year. But
yes.
It's not the time of the game. It's just the inaction. I mean, 6 minutes before a ball is put in play.
Right.
You know, 2,000 more strikeouts than hits. You know, someone said to me, I thought that was perfect, is that if the NFL was like baseball, you'd have a quarterback stand back and throw a bomb on every play. Hey, it's cool when it works, you know, once or twice a game. And that's what's happening in baseball. We're just kind of waiting for a home run. Okay, that lasts 30 seconds of action. But there's no rallies. I mean, the beauty about the NFL or, you know, college football is the drives. And baseball's the rallies. And we don't have it anymore. We don't see guys getting on base and that sort of thing. You know, there's so many former players, Hall of Famers, Goose Gossage, John, that they just discuss it with the game. They say it's hard to even, they can't watch it.
I do respect people who put together analytics. I do. It's not as if I'll sit there and use a stat here and there when the moment is right when I'm broadcasting a game. But I've felt of late that those who love sabermetrics feel it is the only way to win a game, while I look at it as one of the ways to win a game. How do you view that?
Yeah, I mean, you gotta watch the game. It's like when Cash of Tampa Bay, pulled out Blake Snell. I know that was her system and everything else, but you got to watch how he's doing it. The analytics is just, math. It's taking away the human element. Don't tell me a guy can a pitcher can pitch the same way in the ninth inning as the seventh inning. They can't. Guys are different. If there's a one-run lead, some guys can handle it. Some guys can't. Same with pressure moments and things like that. So, analytics has always been part of the game. I mean, it's like math. I remember sitting in the Whitey Herzog's office, and he had spray charts on where guys are hitting, but nobody, said, okay, this is the, it means everything. Let's take out the human element. And that's not right.
Right. And that's different. All right. So there's been, as time has gone in recent years, you talked about spray charts. Spray charts also mean shifts. All right, because you're taking all that knowledge and saying, hey, this is where he hits it. These are his hot spots, so you cover it. Every sport has restrictions on movement somewhere. Baseball defensively does not. Do they need, in your opinion, to think about restricting shifts, just go two left, two right?
They may have to. I mean, at some point, you would hope the hitters would adjust. Like, okay, hit the ball the other way. If they're, nobody's standing on the left side of second base, you can't lay down a bunt or slap the ball that way and probably get a double out of it. But, yeah, maybe you at least start in the dirt. Everybody's got to be in the dirt when the ball is thrown. Then you can run out to on short right field or, what have you. Maybe that, try that in moderation. So I understand, left-handed hitters being frustrated, that sort of thing. But but take advantage of when they're giving you that much space, to hit a ball to the left side and literally you can run to second base. Nobody's around. So, but yeah, we'll see. I think they may have to do something on that just to do something to help the hitters, because it's tough to watch.
I was at a game at Fenway Park, and the Red Sox were playing the Royals, and David Ortiz came to the plate. And of course, they had three guys on the right side. I think in this case, it was the third baseman that was playing in the shortstop spot. And Ortiz dropped a bunt down the third baseline. And of course, even for David Ortiz, he beat it out with relative ease. Okay. And everybody gave him a standing ovation. So I've seen it, I've witnessed it.
I had breakfast a few days ago. Goose Gotchas. You were talking about Boone Powell. He said they shifted on Boone Powell. He goes, Boone Powell laid down by five straight bunts. That's that end of that. They quit shifting on Boone Powell. It's take what they give you.
Right, exactly. What's this been like for you, who loves covering the game, covering personalities, being at a ballpark, to cover the sport this way and what they're doing right now?
Well, it's tough to watch. I mean, some of these games are so dull. It's like I don't mind long games, and when they're exciting, whether it's some of these World Series games, those games in WBC are really exciting. But just have to see some action. And so the trouble is now, in the last couple of years, with the COVID restrictions, so you're not in the clubhouse talking to players or manager coaches. Zoom call type thing. You're not seeing the baseball scouts around, so you're not talking to them. So you're relegated to just sitting there and watching a game that's become dull. I mean, I love the postseason. I'm not saying the postseason is dull, but there's too many games that just take forever. without a ball being put in play.
Yeah, because I was talking to Corey Provis, who does the Twins, and Jason Benetti, who does the White Sox, and they both do Big Ten basketball. That's why, you know, I've had a chance to talk with them along the way. And, of course, because of COVID, they can't really get around the batting cage that often. How tough has that been to get away from that part of it? And are you concerned that they will continue to keep you away from it?
Yeah, I mean, the interaction's nothing like it was, you know. The restrictions are being, reduced or completely eliminated, you know, in different states now and, municipalities. So hopefully they'll let us back in. I did read where the NBA is going to keep reporters out for, maybe forever. They were saying that at the All-Star game. So we'll see. Major League Baseball, at least the communication department, said, hey, everybody's allowed in. You know, you're allowed in pending union approval. So we'll see what the union says. I mean, I can't see being back in a clubhouse in spring. It's going to be too wild, and, you know, let's ease off a little bit with the guys coming from everywhere with COVID. But at some point during the year, I think you got to get back in the clubhouse and just get some nice, personality pieces and perspective so people know who these players are.
That's the part they need to understand. You tell their stories, right? And the vast majority of the stories, are good, right, and fun.
Yeah, particularly in baseball where, come from every walk of life and, you can look like, you can be 6'10" or 5'3" and, have the same kind of career. There's so many good stories in baseball.
Yeah, and you guys tell them. Finally, what's it been like for you trying to cover this and the economics of it and as opposed to covering a game?
Well, it's just so strange. I mean, I don't think 99% of baseball fans could care less. Just, hey, when does the season start? When is the lockout ending? And I don't think they care for the drips and drabs of the labor negotiations. Now it's starting to heat up until, Monday. They got to cancel another, game, week of spring training games. That's going to come, here in a few days. But, it's just not what anybody wants. I mean, the postseason is my favorite time of the year. Spring training is my second favorite time. I love spring training, seeing guys relax. You haven't seen guys all winter. And, now that's eroded big time.
Absolute pleasure. Thanks so much for your time. I really appreciate it.
Sure, my pleasure. Thank you, Steve.
Bob Nightengale, USA Today. We'll come back with more in a moment. Great to have you with us today. Sponsored by our good friends at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 to 15, Hummel's Wharf. Online at sunburymotors.com on News Radio 1070 W.
That he's loved. And that his love for the players allow them to perform like that.
Who's loved?
One Juwan Howard.
Oh, was that Phil?
That was Phil Martelli, yeah.
Oh, that's Phil. Yeah.
Post game last night.
Well, I mean, look, he recruited him. You know, just because he steps out of line or he throws certain people out of shoot around and things like that, that's not his team. With his team, you got to understand that, when you're 30,000 feet on a team, I think you make assumptions about it. When you're around it all the time, you see certain things. And believe me, I mean, I wouldn't doubt they love him. He recruited them. He's around them all the time. They have to go into his office to talk to him all the time. He's got to coach them on the floor all the time. They go on road trips together. They get serious about stuff. They get yelled at, and they laugh. So, this is a team in Michigan, for example, where, like Hunter Dickinson came back. I mean, he's got a lot of guys come back. that I thought were like, hey, maybe they're ready to go, but, you know, but decided to stay. I mean, there's a couple of guys the last couple of years. Isaiah Livers was one. I thought Isaiah Livers was going to go. He stayed. Now, he's not on this year's team because he was finally done, but, you know, again, if you're not around it every day, it's always important that people don't make assumptions about, oh, I can't be right. Well, it very well could be right. You know, you've got to be around it all the time to understand how people feel. I mean, believe me, are there times where you can tell people are not enamored with coaches? Absolutely, you can tell there are times where people are not enamored with coaches. Absolutely. It's not always a kumbaya deal, believe me. But a lot of times, you know, I've been around a lot of teams that are close-knit. And when you have a close-knit team that's really cool, and yeah, they do love the coaching staff, and they do love the coach very, very much. They'll run through a wall for him. You know, like, ah, you'd run through a wall for that guy? And, you know, again, it depends on what your experience is. Because, you know, do you get yelled at? Yeah. Do you get criticized? Yeah. Do you get corrected? Yes. Do you get praise? Yes. Do you laugh and kid around? Yes. You know, how well, you know, does he know your family? Yes. Now, when push comes to shove, is he, you know, the kind of person that will, you know, the rest of your life will be a major connection to help you in life because loyalty is a two-way street? Yeah, I mean, you'll see that over and over again. You know? So I don't doubt they love him. I don't doubt that at all. I don't think, you know, I've talked to Phil enough and know him well enough to know he's not going to sit there and he's not going to BS you about how they feel about the deal. You know? I'm glad, you know, to be honest with you, I mean, Phil coaching is kind of, you know, to me, it's kind of cool. I like Phil. Oh. That's why, you know, they won last night over Rutgers when I'm sitting there like going, oh, yeah, Phil's coaching, real big shock. Phil knows how to coach.
I am amazed, though, that he does tolerate Juwan Howard.
Yeah, but you don't know the working relationship with them.
I know.
Just because Juwan Howard gets mad at pick, you know, opposing team, opposing coach, an official, whatever. Okay? Let me give you an example. The first basketball coach I work with here at Penn State was Dick Carter. There are a lot of people around here that struggled with Dick Carter. Guess who got along great with Dick Carter and he got along great with me? It was Dick Carter. Dick Carter and I got along great. But there are a lot of people around here that did not. But he and I were always fine. Never an issue. He's always caught up with me later in life to see how I was doing.